'cause I'm tired of these scenes.
We are not in next week, so we'll check you in following the new year, correct? Okay, so we won't be back until the new year. The best of all holidays, free time, whatever it is that, however it is that you observe this time of year, into your heart, into your homes, into your families, we wish you absolutely the best. Thank you so much from beloved Detroit.
Listen up, America. Are you or a loved one suffering with an addiction to alcohol, opiates, prescription painkillers, or other drugs? There is hope. Medication-assisted treatment is proven most effective for opiate addiction recovery. Utilizing medications such as methadone, Suboxone, and Subutex, combined with inpatient treatment, you can achieve lasting recovery. Most insurance is accepted, so call us now.
Please call 800-625-5860.
So, you've decided to go to college. That's cool. So, pop quiz. Which is a better way to earn your degree? Commute to college and fill your gas tank, get stuck in traffic, drive in bad weather, try to find a parking space, walk a half mile to class, or learn online at Independence University. You don't go to college. College goes to you. That's Independence. That's Independence University. And all your supplies, including a brand new laptop and tablet, are included with tuition. Independence U for an independent you.
Call 1-800-556-7791.
Do you owe more than $10,000 to the IRS? If so, you may qualify for the IRS's Fresh Start Program. The Fresh Start Program is one of the biggest tax breaks the IRS has offered. Call Tax Group Center at 800-685-6150 to see if you qualify for the IRS's Fresh Start Program. Their team of tax experts and attorneys will get you the best tax settlement possible. Call 800-685-6150 now to learn if you qualify for the IRS's Fresh Start Program. Call Tax Group Center at 800-685-6150. 800-685-6150.
3, 2, 1.
You're listening to 910 AM Superstation. You're listening to 910 AM Superstation.
The best in the city.
The views and opinions expressed on any program are those of the producers and or the persons appearing on the program and do not necessarily reflect the views and opinions of 910 AM Superstation or Adele Media. WFDF Farmington Hills, Detroit. 910 AM Superstation, a division of Adele Media.
And good morning. You're listening to Robert Ficano. I have in the studio with me this morning, as usual, Keith Williams. Keith, I know you're getting set up for the big football games that are coming here later on this afternoon. And also Scotty Boman that has joined us as well. Before we get started, a couple of things that we should observe and what we know are coming up on Monday, which is the Martin Luther King holiday that was pushed finally to become a national holiday by John Conyers. Congressman John Conyers, he advocated for this year upon year upon year upon year, and finally Congress adapted it. So you want to give credit to someone that, you know, pushed this and made it possible for us to observe it. And many of the activities are going to be there on Monday. But I know, Keith, that you traditionally with the youngsters, you got an event coming up that swings around Martin Luther King holiday. So why don't you explain it to us?
You know, on Martin Luther King holiday, you got the walks. You got the church church affairs. Well, I'm doing something like this. I started last year with Wayne State under the relationship with Robert Fournier, the athletic director. And I'm putting on a pro day for the kids. It only costs $50, but the money goes back to nonprofit. But the deal is that the kids get to work out with 8 Major League scouts.
That's
from
right.
The Tigers, the Yankees, Oakland A's. These are legitimate scouts. These scouts they can say yay or nay to a kid. So it's going to be down in Wayne State. I keep, you know, the new building down there right across from the football field. You can't miss it. If you want to know anything about it, call me at 313-215-4121. It only costs $50. You get to see some Major League scouts. You got college kids coming down, high school kids. I'm just trying to get them acclimated to something different, something that, you know, they don't see on an ordinary basis.
Now, is this going to be tomorrow?
It's tomorrow.
Okay.
Martin Luther King holiday.
And what time does it?
It goes from 10 o'clock, 10 o'clock to 2 o'clock.
And so there's going to be Major League scouts that work scouts. For the organizations that they represent.
No bootleg scouts. These are real scouts.
These are real people that actually can make a recommendation. Yes. They file a formal scouting report with the organization.
Yes.
And there's if you've ever seen a scouting report, they go through the checklist and everything else about your speed and things like that that they actually monitor.
You know, Bob, a couple of my, you know, since I had opened up my facilities, you know, I have got a couple of kids in college and a couple of kids there, and now are in the pros. They came through my building, you know, and so I'm just a little building off of Schoolcraft in Auburn Street. It's not the best looking from the outside, but you know something's not on the
it's
outside.
It's the heart in the
it's
inside.
The heart, it's inside, man. You know, and Bob, I don't get, you know, I don't get the money that Pal gets and all these other guys get, but you know, I've been at it since 2012. It's your heart. My heart is in the right place, and God knows my heart and know what I'm trying to do for these kids.
And what's unique about it is that a lot of African-American sports, these kind of programs push basketball and even like sometimes football. Yours, that has fallen off a little bit, which is African-Americans participating in baseball. You don't see as many in you know, Major League Baseball as you do Latinos and some of the others.
You know, when you go back, I have looked at some Jackie Robinson. Jackie Robinson was a trailblazer. But it was the people in Negro Leagues were the trailblazers. He came. He was a byproduct of the Negro Leagues, Bob. Those guys, man, imagine if they had the money that some of these owners have. Now, Negro League could have been one of the great leagues
Satchel
of all
Paige,
time.
Satchel Paige.
Man, these guys.
He was finally, when he got in, he was striking people out at 40 years old.
43 years old. He said, don't look back. Somebody's following you. You know what I'm saying? Bob, but think about it. The number of men ran the money. They had their own marketing. Just what? They ran a business.
Yeah,
but they had alternative finances back in those days, man. You know.
Yeah. Well, it's come a long way. In fact, just this past weekend, I saw that somebody they had unique photos, and one of the unique photos was Jackie Robinson stealing home in one of the World Series games.
Well, Bob, then you just fast forward out of that. You know, the Civil Rights Movement came, and you know, I was just when we was walking in. Four guys lost their life for freedom. I call them freedom fighters, but even Medgar Evers, he was one that was five, Medgar Evers. And then Val Luisio and the two of the three kids that were going down on the bus trip in Mississippi. You know what I'm saying? And they lost their lives. The question is, do we have people?
And some very famous ones, obviously Martin Luther King,
Robert Kennedy, and all those folks. And then John F. Kennedy had to be sold on civil rights. Bobby
eventually came through.
Yeah, but they finally came through.
Yeah.
But LBJ took it to the next level. But the bottom line is this, Bob. Do we have freedom fighters like those guys now?
Do you have somebody that are willing to lose their life today? That would be interesting.
They won't do it. No, they're so used to living in the corporate suites now. You know, drinking nice wine and... That's just like the auto show. You know, everybody walk around with nice dresses. They ain't going to go out there and do what those guys do.
And the other one is protesters were out there Friday night, you know, concerned about what was going on with the closing with General Motors and some of the others. And I think General Motors is getting a lot more heat than people realized when they first announced it.
It's the bottom line, Bob. We bailed them out.
We bailed them out, and they're making a lot of money.
Before
the excuse or the reason was, look, we're heading towards a crash point. We got to do something dramatic in order to save the company. Now they're making more money than they ever made, and they said, "Well, we're still going to close plants down."
But, I was one of the few people locally, I think, actually out there expressing a view against bailing them out, which I know wasn't really popular as a Detroiter, but I think it was just a bad idea for the government to get into picking winners and losers in the auto industry.
Yeah, but I think that saved a lot of jobs in this area. I think I know you're libertarian.
Yeah, you're libertarian, man. But when you look at the common good, man, you destabilize the communities. You had to just bail those folks out, man.
Yeah, I mean, this area would have been devastated.
Ohio would have been devastated.
And not only that, you would have hurt the suppliers, and you would have hurt Ford Motor Company. People don't realize the suppliers need the three autos in order to survive.
Yeah.
If you knock off one of them where they go bankrupt, then they aren't able to come up to speed and help. And Ford Motor Company, and that didn't take any of the bailout would have had an impact.
Let me tell you what happened.
People would still be buying cars from somebody, though.
Yeah, but not from, we were at the American made cars.
Yeah, Toyota and some of the others.
Let me tell you what happened real quick. I went, you know, DT, he had this fabulous party. So you go over there, they and then they take you back to, take you over to Cobra Hall. Then I came back, me and my wife. So we ate dinner, and we went to the valet, so it was time to leave. So I was getting my coat out of the car. And so I said, we'll get a guy a $5 tip. I gave the guy a tip, and he said, thank you. So when I got in the car, I realized I gave him a $100 bill. And my wife
Can
said,
I be your valet?
My wife realized he put emphasis on thank you. My wife said this, God has blessed you to give us $800 tickets to be transported to a nice affair. God probably wanted you to give that man that $100.
Maybe God wanted you to, but you probably had second thoughts about it.
Well, Bob, after I did it, I said, well,
what are you gonna do?
What it is. But the last couple of days, I've been getting a little blessing. So you never know where your blessings come from.
You're absolutely right. We have a number of callers that are already coming on. We have Scotty Boman, Bob Ficano, obviously, here, and Keith Williams. Jerry from Warren. Jerry, you're on with the three of us here.
Thank you, and good morning to you, gentlemen. And happy Martin Luther King Day. I believe it's his birthday, right, Mr. Ficano?
Tomorrow is the actual day.
And how old will be if he was still alive?
I don't know. Do you know, Keith? 90s. Okay.
Yeah.
My God, where the time is going. The time is a flying. Well, just like yesterday, I remember they say the civil rights leader was assassinated, you know. And of course, that was a bad day. That was a disaster for our nation. Because I remember Mr. Ficano, Mr. Scott, Mr. Keith, when I called 3 decades ago, there was a station they called the Queen Station. I don't know if it still exists or not. And the DJ was Mr. Jay Butler. I believe it was on 1400 or 1460 AM. Yes, sir. Yes, sir, Mr. Williams. So I do remember when I called, and at that time, Dr. Martin Luther King's, there was no such a holiday to celebrate his birthday.
John Conyers was very instrumental in pushing that.
Well, that's why I want to salute the Dean of the Congress, Mr. Conyers. I want to give him my appreciation for all the good things he did for our country, for all the American, for his people. And thank you, John Conyers, Congress John Conyers, for what you did. Thank you for your service, and God bless him. Now, gentlemen, what I want to say over here, when I called 3 decades ago Mr. Jay Butler, he said, Jerry, brother, like a joke, what are you doing calling me? You are an Arab, Middle Eastern. What does this has to do with you? I say, excuse me, Mr. Butler, please, I got to stop you there. Because Dr. Martin Luther King did not come for black. He came for Arab first, Asian first, blue and black and brown. He came for everybody. And one of the reasons, gentlemen, I respect him, because he followed the steps of Jesus Christ. He followed the step of like Mahatma Gandhi in India. He took the freedom with peace and love. That's why I'm proud about Dr. Martin Luther King. He did not shoot a bullet.
He was for nonviolence, but there was quite a bit of tension that was during the time that, you know, unfortunately, that he tragically lost his life. There was a lot of tension that was starting to rise, whether the pacifist approach was getting everybody's attention the way it should. And there were some that were starting to advocate that they should have been, the groups should have become more aggressive in what they were trying to reach out for.
Amen.
And things like that.
Yes, gentlemen, I do remember.
Malcolm X was pushing for a more
aggressive approach as to what was going to be necessary.
Now, Mr. Ficano, excuse me if I address this question to all of you gentlemen. The dream was there, and I love the dream, and I salute the dream of Dr. Martin Luther King, and I have a dream. My children have a dream. My grandchildren have a dream. My question to you, gentlemen, is the dream of Dr. Martin Luther King still exist?
No.
That's number one. That's before
the dream exists. I don't think the results are there.
I'll let you answer just when I finish, if you don't mind. Let's say if the dream still exists or not, then we'll hear the answer. The second question is the legacy and the dream of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. was hijacked. And it was hijacked especially by some brother African-American leaders who they used his name and dream and legacy for their own agenda.
So what you mean by hijacked?
I think they were advocating what he wanted to do.
You never can replace a person like Martin Luther King. You got surrogates, and surrogates take on their own life on their own. So I don't know if it was hijacked.
At the time of his death, Jesse Jackson, there were a number of people that have on their own become, you know, pretty well known within the movement.
Brother Keith, when I say hijack, I'm not trying to accuse a certain leader trying to copycat Dr. Martin Luther King. But I try to say when a certain politician tried to run for office or something, and when he tried to go back in the 60s to what Dr. Martin Luther was standing for, they can use or copy a part of Dr. Martin Luther to serve their own agenda, just like what happened in the revolution of Egypt in January about 5 years ago. You remember how the people, the nation in Egypt, they irised against
Jerry, I appreciate it. You know, because it's Martin Luther King holiday, we've got a lot of callers that want to comment on it. So we appreciate you calling and want you to continue to do so.
Yeah, I wanted to comment on the dream being alive or dead. When Commissioner Burton, who you hear sometimes on the show, we were over at Wayne State University this week. I think it may have been right on his birthday. It was either Tuesday or Wednesday. His birthday, by the way, was Tuesday. We spoke to them, and there was definitely a lot of enthusiasm still for Martin Luther King's message. There was a lot of questions also, though, about really who's going to pick up the torch. And like one person, Linda Bernard, who was there, she had commented that Jesse Jackson was a good person. And actually me and the host here have actually heard Reverend Jackson back on Saturday. This week ago Saturday. When he was speaking to us, but you know, he, and you just mentioned how Martin Luther King would be 90. Mr. Jackson is getting up there, and what I had commented is wherever you see a person, based on the message that Martin Luther King carried forward to us, that those people are picking up the torch, and it's not going to be one person, I think, but many. I mean, you need really a large, you know, movement to really transform the country.
Okay.
But the bottom line is the leaders, you got to have a moxie. I don't see a moxie in these leaders. You know, they poll-driven or they Facebook-driven and all that.
Yeah,
other
the
stuff.
Social media has changed it completely to how they
you
come
gotta
across.
You got to have a person with moxie who has stature and who has some substance. And I don't know if you got that right now.
Yeah, there was an article today on O'Rourke, and he's running out. He was the one that tried to beat Senator Cruz in Texas. And what he does now is everything is on Twitter. He goes to the dentist, and you can see his open mouth on Twitter. Because he's showing you what he's doing at the dentist and stuff. That seems a long way from the dream of, okay, these are the principles we believe in, and here's how we got to drive, you know, our institutions towards it. The whole Twitter has changed, including President Trump. Has changed everything in the way that it's approached. Okay, we have a number of callers. Let's get to a couple of them here. John, you're on with Bob Ficano, Keith Williams, and Scotty Bowman.
Hey, good morning. Yes, I just wanted to say something about Martin Luther King. Then I want to talk about General Motors. Martin Luther King, I think he was a Republican before John Kennedy made him change.
No, we don't know that. We don't know. His father
what,
was.
What makes
we don't know that.
His father
okay,
was.
Okay, he was a Republican before it all.
But what they got to do with anything, man?
Okay, if he was a Republican, he depended on, he ended up getting pretty close to President Johnson and the federal courts and everything else.
He had to because he was facing a lot of demons on that side. Now, I want to talk about General Motors. General Motors, they got the taxpayers bailed them out. Okay,
sure.
I haven't received a dividend check for bailing out General Motors, and now the people that are attacking General Motors, they're worried about their corporate profits. General Motors, Mary Barra, she's got a lot of pensioners and a lot of employees she's got to pay, and then we go back to Chrysler. You guys remember Chrysler got bailed out, but when Lee Iacocca took over Chrysler back in the 80s, he only worked for a dollar just to save Chrysler. So they better be careful what they're doing. That's all I'm saying.
Yeah, John. Well, I think Mary Barra actually makes about $22 million a year is her actual salary.
Well, is she willing to work for a dollar like Lee Iacocca?
Well, but I'm sure her circumstances are much different than Lee Iacocca as well, but
The people that are attacking Mary Barra or General Motors, are they willing to shut their pensioners off, their shareholders? They willing to do this? Because that's what's going to happen if they don't be careful. I'm just saying, be careful what you're doing.
Yeah, well, you know, the problem is that General Motors got a lot of subsidies, including from Wayne County when we were in there for that auto plant, the Poletown.
Mr. Ficano.
Yeah.
I got something for you. If anything has to be subsidized from the government, then it's probably not needed. That goes the same
okay,
thing
well,
with the federal government.
You know, you're working at the post office and they're subsidized.
You gotta come with that. Stop coming with that bipolar talk, man. Come on. You working at the post office. You went to the Army. You've been sucking off the trough. And you come in and talk about General Motors.
If it has to be subsidized, it's probably not needed, guys. You know.
What, so the post office isn't needed? The military isn't needed?
The post office, I understand, has been breaking even, haven't they?
They have a different mechanism by which they get funded. But ultimately, the federal government bails them out if there's a problem.
Yeah, you got bureaucracy. That's all.
Yeah, right. You eating off government money every day.
No, I'm just giving a warning. That's all I'm doing.
Okay.
Okay.
Are you going to retire from the post office?
I mean, about 18 months.
18 months, and you're going to do it. You're going to be calling us as a retiree, collecting some of that federal pension then.
Yeah, federal pension.
No, I'm paying for my pension. I'm not the civil service guys. Civil service ended under the Reagan administration. Remember, when the Democrats...
Yeah, but you have a match, right, John? Even if it's a 401k, you have a match, correct?
I don't know what they're doing now. They're matching something, and then
it's a match. Yeah, sure it is. You just don't take your part of your paycheck, put it in for retirement. The government matches some of it in 401k. It may not be one-to-one. You know, you might put in $4 or $3, then they match $1 or something like that.
I put in 12% now.
Okay, but the government matches in there as well. The employer matches as well. That's how most 401ks work. So they are subsidizing part of what you're doing for your retirement.
Okay.
Yeah, but subsidies don't work, man. You know,
Okay. You have a blessed day, Macomb County.
Okay, thanks, John. Thanks for calling in. I believe we have to go to break.
No.
Okay. And so, LaShonda, you're on with us.
Good morning to all three of you.
Good morning.
I just wanted to mention that I attended the Women's March yesterday morning. And I tell you, if it was not a who's who list of our political great women, absolutely wonderful. Just kind of networking, I discovered one young reporter who had come all the way from Washtenaw. It was a really unexpected but pleasant event. And I tell you,
it was a rally actually at the African American Museum, right? I mean, they held it inside eventually.
Charles H. Wright, right?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
You know, I had a guy called me. He said, "Would y'all support a men's movement like that?" I'm just telling what a guy told me yesterday. This guy, he was getting upset. He said, it was last year, now it's a continuation. And he said, what about the men? I'm just telling what they said. Now, I'm not me. I agree with you guys. Do you agree with y'all doing? But there's some guys out there getting a little upset about that.
I wonder why. I think that would be nice. I'll tell you why. You know, the photograph that was in front of the podium was of Dr. King. And it was absolutely, as I can picture, men making their point to whatever the subject may be. With a photograph like that there, you just can't go wrong. I don't know why there would be even a second thought to men gathering, such as, you know, the event yesterday. It's just kind of troubling. But my last question is, are you at all promoting, Mr. Williams, the H.R. 1242-400-year African American History Commission Act, or are you talking about that? It's kind of...
I don't know. I don't want to sound dumb, you know, but tell me what that is.
Yeah, explain what that is.
Yes.
Oh, you asking me? I'm sorry.
Yes.
Oh, well, that is a bill that was eventually signed by Donald Trump. They developed a commission, and the commission's duties are to promote towards businesses, churches, schools, individuals, any concepts, whatever programs that you want to put together that has anything to do with the 400-year commemoration of African Americans who, of course, first arrived into the Americas.
So,
and that commission and the funds that are available.
Has that commission met yet?
Oh, yes. It's an actual act now.
I know he passed it, but he's pretty famous sometimes for putting commissions together, such as when they were looking for election fraud and stuff, and they weren't able to find it.
But, ma'am, I'm going to tell you, stay tuned for something. In July, the first week of July 13th, I'm getting ready to put on a festival of African Americans in the city of Detroit. And it coincides with the opening of my Courageous Games for Kids at Wayne State. We're going to be doing swimming, basketball, track and field, the whole shot. But the festival is about the greatness of African Americans, and we're not separating anybody else, but I'm just trying to do some cultural things. Stay tuned. It's got some soul in it. I can't tell you the whole deal, but next week on the show, I'll go in depth with it.
Would you turn down $20,000 just for what you're doing, if that was available to you? Because that's pretty much what they're saying.
I pray on Donald Trump's money. But
it's not Donald Trump. It's not Donald. He just signed it. It would be Congressman Bobby Scott.
Out of Virginia. Yeah, I'd just sign on that money. Yeah, I'll take it.
Sure.
I'll take it. Why would I take it? Because that helps with more booths, help with stages and all that.
Thank you so much.
Okay, thanks. All right, Tim, you're on with Bob Ficano, Keith Williams, and Scotty Boman.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I just want to comment a couple things, but number one is the GM bailout. You know, I think everybody's misunderstanding the shareholders, the current shareholders at that time, the bondholders, the preferred shareholders. They're the ones that saved that company because they didn't get anything. And then after, when the company was brought out of whatever it was in, they reissued new shares and new debt and everything. And so those old shareholders, I knew people that had money in retirement with their common stockholders. They lost everything. And then the company turns around and reissues new shares. That's unconscionable to me. That's illegal.
But no, that's basically how bankruptcy works. I mean, the company, if you go through a restructuring, gets a second life. There's the famous old GM and new GM, and the old GM had assets like some of the factories and things like that. And they were trying to sell some of that. If whatever things they were able to sell and stuff, they were able to then distribute the proceeds to the old stockholders and bondholders and things like that. I don't know how successful it actually ever became in the process.
Yep. I didn't know it worked that way.
Different. Yeah, but this is a different thing. This is a hybrid thing because the government was involved in this.
Because they had to actually get the funding. The TARP funds were actually used to be part of it.
I actually went and bought GM shares after when they had were on the decline, thinking that, oh, they're really low, but, you know, whether or not I like it, they're going to get this bailout and the shares are going to be worth more afterward.
Oh,
and
Scotty, instead, you became a capitalist.
Yeah, and on direct experience, I know you're absolutely right. They got zeroed out. It's like, wait a minute, but I thought, like, I thought the shares would gain value. Instead of they just go, no, you guys get zero, and we're going to start over again.
But that's how a bankruptcy works. Look at when Detroit went through it, a lot of the pensioners and stuff, all the dramatic reduction they got in their pensions and stuff. That's how bankruptcy. Right. Nobody likes it, but that's how bankruptcy actually works. It's supposed to be.
But under a real bankruptcy, that company should have been liquidated, and the shareholder, at least the suppliers. The bondholders and the preferred shareholders, that I think they're what would be the first secured creditors, they should have been paid. But the government came in and said, no, that's not happening.
But, sir, let me say this, too. You're talking about a few people. We talk about a greater good, suppliers, people's lives, infrastructure, tax base.
It would have affected the other companies.
That affects a whole lot of stuff. If you let Chrysler and General Motors go out of business, you would have devastated this country.
And nobody would have been paid anything.
I don't like nobody losing their money and stuff. But guess what? When you play high-risk stuff, you know, the return could be great. But when they lose, you lose.
You know what the common denominator is here? Government, once again, doesn't work.
Well, guy, you cannot get around government. When you ride down the street, it's government. When you got an EMS truck come to get you, when you got a heart attack, that's government. When your banking institution is controlled and protected, it's government. Y'all need to get off of that stuff.
Where you have the problem. That's where the problem is. When government.
Then get out of, don't live in the United States if you don't want the government.
Okay. Actually, the banking institutions are backed by the Federal Reserve, which is a cartel of private banks. The president does appoint the chair.
But they guarantee your accounts in the banking, so you don't have another like it happened in the Depression, where once the banks started to close up, nobody had any. You lost all your funds. FDIC protected. Okay, I know we got to go to break. We'll be right back. You're listening to Bob Ficano, Keith Williams, and Scotty Boman.
You know, Bob.
Look, it's really good to see you, friend. Something I realize that I don't even have to mention is whether or not you got me. That's something I never question.
Hi, I'm Hunter Ellis, and this is Atomic Beam USA. Another bright idea from Bulbhead, the ultra-bright, tough-grade flashlight that features tactical technology used by U.S. Special Forces. This flashlight has a feeble 125 lux output. The Atomic Beam USA has up to 5,000 lux. That's 40 times more. We're going to drop it hundreds of feet from this helicopter. It hits the tarmac, and it's still working. That's what I call a tough flashlight. Heavy downpours, mud puddles, even extreme temperatures are no match. You could spend over $100, or the Atomic Beam USA can be yours for just $19.99 with free lifetime guarantee. Order now, you can double it and get a second Atomic Beam USA. Just pay a separate fee, and we'll even ship them to you for free. Atomic Beam USA is just $19.99. Order now.
Call 1-800-638-2619 to get your Atomic Beam USA. Call now or go to atomicbeam.com. So call 1-800-638-2619. Deluxe version available. Order now.
If you or a loved one underwent hernia surgery between 2010 and 2016 and then suffered serious complications, call right now. You may be entitled to financial compensation. Complications associated with PhysoMesh include chronic pain, infection, adhesions, mesh migration, reopening of the hernia, and other serious injuries. Call right now.
Call 1-800-799-2091. Again, that's 1-800-799-2091.
Attention! In July 2018, Bayer announced that it will be halting its sales of Assure. The Assure birth control may break or migrate after insertion, puncturing the fallopian tube, resulting in corrective surgery to remove the device. Thousands of women have reported debilitating health problems to the FDA. In April 2018, the FDA restricted sales of Assure to protect women and require that patients receive risk information.
Please call 800-425-9539.
We all love fried food. But the problem is all that excess oil and fat can cause you to become overweight. Well, now there's the Cook Light Aero Fryer, an amazing kitchen miracle that uses air to fry instead of oil, so you can have the same delicious flavor and crispiness of deep frying using little or no oil. Get that deep fried taste and crispiness with up to 70% fewer calories. Enjoy crispy, delicious fries with little or no oil, guilt-free onion rings, cheesy and delicious mozzarella sticks. Call now and bring the Cook Light Aero Fryer into your home, including the Cook Light Aero Fryer recipe book, the unique patented dual tray, air frying mesh basket and tongs, and stainless steel extender ring. You'll get it all for five easy payments of $29.95. Be one of the first 500 callers and get this 13-piece knife set, a $175 value, yours free. Try Cook Light Aero Fryer for 30 days. If you don't love it, send it back. But keep the 13-piece knife set as our gift to you. Order in the next 10 minutes and we'll include free shipping. Call now or go online to air2fry.com. That's air2fry.com.
And good morning. You're listening to Robert Ficano, Keith Williams, and a special guest, Scotty Boman, who joins us on occasion. And one of the issues that has come up on occasion here is about, and Scotty, I know you wanted to raise it, about some of the issues with some of the incidents concerning Detroit PD. You saw that the major charges against the officer that was involved in trying to calm down the mentally impaired woman in the hospital. I believe those charges were dismissed. There seems to be some turmoil. One of them was dismissed. There seems to be some turmoil within the police union, from what I can tell. The incumbent that was running lost. They were the rank and file apparently were concerned about some of the benefits that were negotiated and things like that in this last contract and things. So, you know, our front line of defense is always the police. And you said that you had a personal experience with one of the people in the neighborhood.
Oh, yeah. Well, yeah, two different things, but they kind of both, the nexus kind of is the Board of Police Commissioners in a way on both of these. One of them, of course, the Board of Police Commissioners had initially turned down Chief Craig's wish to have Officer Jones suspended over his conduct on the incident. Well, and it happened on the 15th, and in the report on the 10th, when he had first gone to court for a preliminary exam, was that he would be back on February 15th, but instead the hearing occurred on January 15th, and they, interestingly enough, Martin Luther King's birthday, and they exonerated him of the misconduct charges, which were the most severe charges. Those are felony charges, and continued to still have the assault charges, which apparently are only misdemeanor charges pending against him. So it just seemed like, to me personally, it felt like a slap in the face to Ms. Williams and the way she was treated by him as a person who possibly maybe even had mental challenges, though I don't think, you know, I'm not a psychologist and neither are the journalists who wrote that, but the appearance in the video is that she has some issues.
They said that they were having a heart, that she was spitting at the officers and striking at them and things like that. And I guess the question is, did he use excessive force in trying to calm her down? I think that became the question, and that's what the judge reviewed at that point.
Yes, and I just feel like that's kind of like it's turning into a whitewash. He's back on duty, and, you know, still as far as whether or not the public's really safe having him on duty if someone else were to be in a similar situation, I'm not confident of that. And then there's the much larger problem.
Yeah, it's hard to tell. See, the problem, Scotty, is that you see a quick clip of what happens as turns to a video, and everything that surrounds it, you never actually get a chance to see. And the court gets to see it, it might have a different picture that's painted at that point.
That's true, but normally when I've heard people comment on what we missed, it usually seems to be justifying some kind of almost retaliatory behavior.
An officer can only use appropriate force to calm the, you know, to take control of the situation. They can't punish you. They can't be doing it to punish you or anything like that. You know, they're supposed to be professional in the way they're supposed to handle it. And I know there's a lot of training that goes into that, that's supposed to go into that, and how to use it. I know when I was sheriff, we did a lot of training on that to make sure there wasn't excessive force that was used on individuals. We have been somewhat fortunate in this area. You don't see it like you have in some other cities like New York. There has been some, obviously, incidents that have happened, but you don't seem to see it as prevalent as you do in New York or what you saw in Ferguson and some of the other areas.
And the training area, actually, you bring up here, I find especially critical, because what I'm getting out of this is that when I heard, and to me, it wasn't just now him, but when you had a whole lineup of officers all saying that this was ideal conduct and that he had done just perfectly the right thing at the commissioner meeting, it seems to me that there's got to be a better way to handle these things, and we need to have our officers trained in better ways. And if they didn't see a better way, there needs to be something looked into here. It just didn't seem right that there are so many people lined up saying that this was just the right way to do things. And I think part of it is having mental health professionals travel along on these runs, giving direct on-the-scene advice when there's something like this. I think they had initially taken her to the hospital, already understanding, the reason they're, in fact, taking her to a hospital.
It's like anything else. It's the cost of having someone travel that as a mental health specialist, that's a whole a whole new layer of what you do in terms of costs and things like that. I don't know if that'd be borne by the city of Detroit, if it'd be borne by the Mental Health Authority. I mean, that's a really, you see how many runs there are in Detroit. To have someone in the car with them that's always a mental health specialist would be really difficult, it seems like, at that point. That doesn't mean that the training shouldn't happen and things like that. And I know they're working towards that and trying to do it. So, well, we have Rick in Detroit. Rick, you're... I'm with Bob Ficano, Keith Williams, and Scotty Boman.
Hey, good morning. I think that continuing that D.R.A.C.O. piece has certainly been an asset because it can be costly just to keep an issue going. But the idea of having some advanced civilian oversight is very necessary. Rather than,
civilian oversight with the police commission. That, in theory, that's what it is. And what's unique, like a sheriff, there's oversight in terms of the voters. I mean, if they don't like what's going on, they can certainly do something about it at the voting booth.
But the thing is, that's much easier said than done. And even though the commission is in place, the commission can only function with the strength that comes from the community. You see, it's not the commission that becomes the key important point here for organizing, but the public. And some of the reason behind the commission was to address and work for the public. And we have it going somewhat the other way. It seems as though one of the more appropriate things to do to kind of create some behavior reinforcement among police would be to raise the value of the citizen interaction with police. I think that, it's no balance there. We need to hear what people are saying. We need to hear those first-party claims. We need to collect. We need to use those things. Not doing that puts the people who are already poor in a lesser position to be effective at advocacy and organizing than others.
Okay, but part of it is attending the police commission, and they have time for public comment. They have time that you engage with them and letting them know if you're unhappy about what you're seeing that's going on in the community.
Well, I want to address that part, too, because when we talk about meetings, I'm a poor person. I live in the city of Detroit. Meetings cost. They cost money. They cost time. They cost resources. And what I prefer, in an upgrade would be when I come to the meeting, have answers, not have me to just recite what my problem is 2 or 3 weeks later. Time has shown, psychology has shown, that when you're recanting something days in the past, weeks in the past, and you're bringing it up, there's a different remembrance of it and a different acknowledgement of it. So if we can get those complaints and that input at the time that they happen or closer to that time, then when people come to these meetings, there ought to be some first-step organizing responses laid out to try to address that problem, if only to put it in a status of continual discovery.
Okay, Rick, that's fine. Okay, thank you very much, Rick. We appreciate it.
May3.com.
It's promoting that website. Yeah. We were talking earlier a little bit, or at least off the air, between Keith and I, that if you're hooked up in the right way, you get some results sometimes that a lot of other people can't get. There's a lead article, I think, in the Detroit Free Press this morning about George Perlis, and he was on the board of trustees for Michigan State. He suddenly resigned, and it took a lot of people back by what was he doing? Why was he suddenly resigning? And by doing that in December, he was given the appointment of that position to Governor Snyder. If he would have waited just till January, then he would have gotten the appointment to the new governor that was coming in, to Gretchen. And so what we found out was that he had made a commitment for $500,000 for his name and his wife's name went on the building. And that commitment was supposed to be $50,000. I forget when it started, but it was supposed to expire and be paid in full by 2012. It wasn't, and it was like $500,000 still owed, and it was canceled. And Keith, that goes a little bit to what you were saying, that if you have the right hookup, things can happen in your favor. Most people don't get debts like that expunged or forgiven.
Yeah, he do like everybody else. When he could become famous, they want somebody else to take care of their problems.
Yeah, it's not a pretty sight that's happening, and we all know that John Engler was let go here this week. That's no surprise. What was the surprise was a replacement for Perlis, which was Nancy Schischling, who is a Democrat, used to be the CEO of Henry Ford, and she replaced him, and she voted with the majority to get rid of him, or was saying that they were going to vote against Mr. Engler before he resigned, that they were going to ask him to leave the position. And instead of just resigning with usually at most a one-page letter, he laid out 11 pages of what he thought was what he had done for Michigan State, and seemed to be a little bit tone-deaf to the victims of Dr. Nasser that eventually was led not only to his downfall, but has continued to give bad publicity to Michigan State.
Whatever happened to 1,000 points of light?
President Bush.
Yeah, what he said. Whatever happened that in the party called conservatives?
Apparently, got extinguished. Not sure what happened to it.
And then George W. Bush, compassionate conservative. I'm trying to. That's an oxymoron, there, isn't it?
Compassionate conservative. Yeah, you don't see very many of them that are compassionate.
Yeah.
With it. Yeah. But anyway, you can join us at 313-778-7600, 313-778-7600 with any of the phone calls.
Scotty, so yeah. you own the commission on what's
Charter
this?
Revision? No.
Charter revision. You own that commission?
No, I'm not on the Charter Commission. I actually, though, did attend the meeting as a citizen.
I think you were there, too, weren't you?
I was there, too.
Oh, okay. We were both there. Okay.
What was your observation 10. Of it?
Sausage making.
Yeah. And that sausage right now is being made from chaos. It was quite the example of what happens when people don't understand or at least follow Robert's Rules of Order. I heard some lip service being paid to Robert's Rules of Order by commissioners who then proceeded to show complete ignorance of it. And it's disappointing because some of the commissioners that I'm talking about are people that I really like and agree with as far as what their vision is for the new charter and for the city. But that vision isn't going to be actualized if they can't have an orderly and productive meeting. And I saw far more cooperation during the candidate forum that D.R.A.C.O. actually had sponsored. We had a candy for them, and they're adversarial there, but actually they were quite cooperative with each other as far as their decorum at that meeting, whereas at the actual charter revision meeting where they're sitting there actually supposed to be discussing these changes, it was like watching
it was the
show.
First meeting, which is oftentimes chaotic. Yeah. That's difficult to put together when it's chaotic like that. The first one, I mean, should they have been probably more organized? Yeah, I mean, you can point to that and say that.
Yeah, Bob, you know what I'm learning about Detroit. You got these little subsets. You got this development corporation here. You got this. So what is the charter going to do for them? that kind of stuff. You know what I'm saying? The charter is still supposed to be the Bible of the city, how you run city government. But do they apply that?
Well, first of all, why'd it come up so quick after the last charter revision?
Yes,
that's one of the questions.
Because somebody had an agenda.
I heard one of the former commissioners, I don't remember the name, but at the meeting, someone had brought up that they had contacted one of the former commissioners with that question, and that the response was that the state had inserted it into the charter after it had already been, the draft had already been put together by the previous commission.
So it was voted on to say that this vote had to come up. I mean, it wasn't the charter that this vote had to come up, whether you wanted to have a charter review. What was unorthodox about it is that, what was it, 4 years later? I don't know how many years it was. Usually charter reviews are anywhere from 10 to 20 years after something's put in. What is
somebody
it?
Obviously had an agenda.
Yeah, well, yeah. What it was is, I think maybe there was confusion about this, was that it's supposed to be amended every 16 years at minimum, but there was a vote to have it amended sooner. And what that should have done is then reset the clock, so 16 years from then it would come up to a vote automatically.
Scotty, I doubt if anything's usually something like that not intentional. Somebody did have an agenda or a reason why they wanted to do that.
Right. And instead, what ended up happening was that because it was, in other words, 2018 was 16 years after the previous amendment, not the 2012 charter, but the one before that, that they end up setting the clock way back to that. Like, they never reset the clock.
Okay. There's a couple other, we've got a guest coming up at 9 o'clock on if you want to appeal your taxes, how you do it, both from a commercial standpoint and from a residential. That's part of it. A couple other news items that have hit. One, I don't know if you've seen it, the Native American that was at the the march on Friday. He was surrounded by a number of
America.
And he was surrounded by a number of teens that started mocking and trying to intimidate him. They were from a Catholic school. The Catholic school immediately had to put out a press release that that they were sorry that their students had done this. And you're right; it's part of now. Look at what Donald Trump has shown us, what way to react to what's going on.
Also, Bob, we got another thing. We got the Democratic elections on February 2nd.
That's right. Okay. Convention at Cobo Hall.
Yeah, but the chair on Saturday at Great Emanuel, we haven't the candidates come to discuss the future.
This
of the
coming Democratic. Saturday?
This Great Emanuel at 19170 Schaefer, and they're going to be talking about the future of the Democratic Party. And I'm a Lavora fan. She
just sent me
mailing. Stabilized. She ran the operation, and we was victorious. We went in debt and stuff like that. But I like Greg Bowen too. But we're gonna support Lavora. But the bottom line is this: Greg and all of them need to come together and be part of and form a team. You know, because there's a lady out of Northfield, too. I forgot her name. She called me. And so the Black Caucus is going to be dealing with that on next Saturday.
How many
Saturday.
Candidates are there, do we know?
It's about four.
Four right now? Okay.
Right.
Okay.
All the party elections are coming up.
But the governor and Senator Stabenow have thrown their support behind
Lavora,
which traditionally the governor has always been able to shape the party once they take over. Like the exception was Snyder. Governor Snyder had a hard time with the Republicans. But traditionally, if you have a governor that's of your party, they traditionally shape the party that they're leading in what happens, both on the national scale. You're seeing it with President Trump. He's turning the Republicans into the Trump party. Right. In the way that it's being set up. And you're going to see it now with Gretchen Whitmer, that she's going to be able to probably put her stamp on the Democratic Party.
You know, there's some, you got some people now a little upset by the configuration I'm hearing out there in the universe about all white males club or all white club and stuff like that. But, give Gretchen a chance. You know, you got to give the lady a chance, man, to shape her vision and try to bring it to reality. But the bottom line is, I now understand those caucuses. They play a viable role in the shaping of a government, man. If Gretchen wanted to be successful, she needed to make sure those caucuses get resources and shape them in her vision.
I attended the session that Carol Kane had with Governor Gretchen Whitmer on Friday. They had a forum. They call it a breakfast that the Free Press puts on. And what was difficult is that she's only been in office for 18 days. At that time, it was 18 days. And so you're asking her, how are you going to fund the roads project? Now, that came up several times. People wanted to know what was going to happen with the roads.
Bob, you should have an answer because you don't want to put it out there. You should. See, the bottom line is you got to transfer that conversation into reality.
Into governing.
Yeah, into governing. And so you cannot just put stuff out there and say, well, you know. You
fix the damn roads.
Yeah, people want people don't want Trump answers anymore. Okay, they want some reality stuff.
Well, she said she's working on a plan that's really going to fix the roads. One of the questions is, are you willing to pay a lot more taxes? Because apparently it might be going in that direction in terms of how you're going to fix the roads and what's going to happen with it.
Yeah, there seems to be something up with that because if I recall right, you know, we had a tax bill or tax increase already. We had a sales tax go up from and to fix roads and why, you know, and the people actually voted against a tax increase and then the legislature went doing it anyway. Well, we had
but they,
roads
they,
before
they spread
that.
It out over like 30 years or 20 years. I mean, but yeah. By the time you accumulated any money, you'd be repairing roads over and over again.
But
I mean,
we had roads before that tax increase, and they were better before, and now we got another tax increase. It just seems like
well, I think
going
we just ignored
the
roads for
well.
So many years. I mean, they pushed it off. They bonded for it, and then they, you know, they repaired some of them. It just there hasn't been a coherent strategy to say – both, how are you going to make it be fixed for a long period of time, not just for, you know, the barrels appear 2 years later because you're repairing what you just laid down and things like that. Before we go to break, we got Jerry. Jerry, you're on with the three of us here. Jerry?
Hello?
Yes,
hello?
You're on. You're on the air.
Yeah. This is aimed at Keith. I wanted to say, when he was waiting kind of commissioner, he was the flop. He's a flop at the Black Caucus. He should go sit his ass down somewhere and just try that for a while.
I don't have to defend him because he's here right now, but I think there's a whole different view on what Keith has been able to do with his youth programs and some of the things that he's talked about in terms of social justice and things like that. But
Bob,
he's here, and so he
Bob,
can defend
you know,
himself.
I can defend myself. I had a wonderful career with the Wayne County Commission.
And yeah, I can attest because I was the exec at the time. Yeah, and he wasn't a flop.
Me and Bob worked together.
I was in his district, 48221, and he did nothing for us.
Where did you stay, sir? What street did you stay on?
Go sit down. Go sit down.
Okay, you ain't, okay. You got a problem. Go. You have a blessed day. Go to church.
Okay. Thank you. Well, you always have people that are not going to be happy. It seems like all we do is spew hate around every day. When we get up, there's going to be people that are just ticked off about something, and they just
Bob,
keep spewing it.
We did some wonderful stuff in that district, from parks,
roads. We did some of the roads.
Roads. I did a whole lot over there.
A lot of the programs for seniors. Shore program.
People don't realize this. In 3 years, me and Bob were working together,
football
we
helmets.
Spent $3 million on nonprofits. We spent money for helmets for kids who were leaving the city of Detroit. We fixed the roads. We tore down houses. I don't know where that guy get that. I think he's on the other team that's running against me for the Black Caucus chair. But the bottom line is this, Bob. I got into it with my heart. I didn't go after him for the money because that's never was my makeup. You know what I'm getting at? I did it because
we found for political office, you never satisfy everybody 100%. If you're making decisions, you're going to tick off somebody. So
I better go sit somewhere now. You go sit somewhere.
Okay, Jim, hold on. We'll get to you right after the break.
How you been, baby? But I'm saying, even though we probably link up every now and then with minimal combo, look, it's really good to see you, friend.
Hi, I'm Hunter Ellis, and this is Atomic Beam USA. Another bright idea from Bulbhead, the ultra-bright, tough-grade flashlight that features tactical technology used by U.S. Special Forces. This flashlight has a feeble 125 lux output. The Atomic Beam USA has up to 5,000 lux. That's 40 times more. We're going to drop it hundreds of feet from this helicopter. It hits the tarmac, and it's still working.
That's what I call a tough flashlight.
Heavy downpours, mud puddles, even extreme temperatures are no match. You could spend over $100, or the Atomic Beam USA can be yours for just $19.99 with free lifetime guarantee. Order now, you can double it and get a second Atomic Beam USA. Just pay a separate fee, and we'll even ship them to you for free. Atomic Beam USA is just $19.99. Order now.
Call 1-800-638-2619 to get your Atomic Beam USA. Call now or go to atomicbeam.com. So call 1-800-638-2619. Deluxe version available. Order now.
Stay up to date with current events and breaking news on our Facebook page. Search and like 910 AM Superstation on Facebook, and you'll see everything new, everything exciting, and all things Detroit. 910 AM Superstation News on Facebook Live right now. Look no further than 910 AM Superstation.
3, 2, 1.
Let's go. 910 AM Superstation.
Hi, I'm Joan London with A Place for Mom. Over the years, we've helped thousands of families find senior care, and today's senior living communities have never been better. With amazing amenities like movie theaters, exercise rooms and swimming pools, public cafes, bars and bistros, even pet care services. And nobody understands your options like the advisors at A Place for Mom. These are local expert advisors that will partner with you to find the perfect place and determine the right level of care, whether that's just a helping hand or full-time memory care. Best of all, it's a free service. Call today, A Place for Mom. You know your family, we know senior living. Together, we'll make the right choice.
Call A Place for Mom right now to get our free ebook on financing senior care, as well as a free referral for senior living communities in your area. Call 1-800-436-2907. That's 1-800-436-2907.
The day you lose your strength is the day you lose your independence. Muscle is lost with age, affecting your energy, balance, and mobility. Before you know it, you're depending on others just to get through the day. But you can reverse and prevent muscle loss. Introducing MyoHealth, a revolutionary proven approach to increased muscle strength and function in as little as 30 days. Live life on your terms with more energy and confidence.
After a serious health issue put me down, MyoHealth's getting me back up again.
And doing activities that I haven't done for a long time, it really works.
MyoHealth is a safe, natural dietary supplement, the result of decades of research and 24 human clinical studies. You can live stronger at any age with greater strength, mobility, balance, and energy. Call or go online now and take the MyoHealth 30-Day Strength Challenge.
40 million. That's the number of free phones still available and the number of how many Americans can still get prescriptions free.
Free could be wonderful.
That's why I'm still working at 77 years old to pay off my prescriptions.
I needed to have a prescription filled and I had to leave because I couldn't afford it.
Call now and see what's available for you.
You're listening to 910 AM Superstation.
The best in the city.
WFDF Farmington Hills, Detroit, 910 AM Superstation, a division of Adele Media.
And good morning. You're listening to Robert Ficano. I have with me Keith Williams and Scotty Boman. We're going to get to our special guest in a minute, but before we do that, we promised Jim that we'd let him finish up with his call. Jim, you're on with the three of us here. Jim?
How you doing?
Great. What's your question, Jim?
I was wondering, I got this for you and Keith. I want to ask y'all, do you think in the last 40 years that we have been putting the wrong people in city government?
I can say unequivocally yes and no.
What was the question, Keith?
Yeah, have we put the wrong people
in city government for the last 40 years? Because
we put a bad one in at the top, right, at the president.
At least George Bush had some compassion. The Bush had compassion.
Thousand points in line.
No,
man.
But the bottom line is this. In local government, people should stop running for office to get a job and
do it for a passion and want to make a difference.
Yeah, you want to make a difference. Because I tried to make a difference. You know, Bob, let me tell you, Scotty, when I tell candidates, have you did a swap analysis on your communities? And they ask me, what is that? the strength, weakness, opportunity presents, okay? You need to find the strengths of your community and the weaknesses and work on the weaknesses using the strength as a force to get things done.
Yeah, yeah.
These guys, Bob, they get them, they go on Facebook.
Do you think after Martin Luther King passed away, the so-called civil rights pioneer, like Jesse Jackson and the ones under him, do you think if with the black-on-black crime in the United States, do you think they should have went out and protest like they did during the civil rights movement when they were lynching and hanging the brothers for no reason? Do you think they should have went out throughout this country and said, look here, black folks, stop killing each other?
Okay, can I say something to you, sir?
I personally think it would have made a big impact, input, if they had to do that.
Okay, so can I say something?
Go ahead. Jim, let Keith say something.
In the spirit of Martin Luther King, there was a statistic that came out, sir. Sir, listen to me. There was a statistic that came out on Facebook 2 weeks ago. In the 1960s, 40% of African Americans owned businesses. 87% of African American families with two parents. Right now, only 7% owns businesses, and 25% owns two-parent families. The question is, lack of resources can cause a lot of things, cause the family disruption. I asked today. I'm gonna be at giving a speech, and I'm gonna talk about when you close plants, when automation comes in. And when you got drugs coming in the community, crime goes up. And the tax base gets eroded when people leave. And so these families that used to live off of stuff like the automotive industry and similar industry that goes along with automotive industry, they get shut down, Bob. What happens to a family?
You start to break apart.
Apart. Then you start,
the drugs and things like that become much more attractive.
All that permeates.
And you have a lot of young black guys not raised with the male role model. Do you think it would have been a good thing if they'd have had an all-male academy like Devin McGriff tried to come forth with the Board of Education years ago?
Devin McGriff. I don't have no problem with all-male academy. All-male
academy. That way the young fellas who don't have a father in the household, that would have helped them to become men.
But the bottom line is this. The church was the engine that drove the civil rights movement, drove the spiritual movement, and we got to get back to the church. Some of the churches, not all, have forgot their mission to free the poor and help the oppressed.
Okay.
So that's what that's all about to me.
Jim, we appreciate it. We have our guest that's coming on. Jumana, are you with us?
Yes, I am. Good morning.
Okay, good morning. On with Scotty Boman and with Keith Williams. Full disclosure, married to her, but she's talking about appeals and tax appeals and the season's coming up. There are a lot of people that are unhappy with what their taxes are, both on the commercial side. Keith was talking to me about it, that he doesn't like the way his commercial building is appraised. And a lot of people, and especially in the city of Detroit, for years, and it's been recognized by the current administration that there was an overall appraisal of what the values were of the property. And Scotty has been through this as well with some of the appeals. So before we get into some of their individual cases, can you just tell us what the process is? So if somebody doesn't like what their taxes are and want to appeal it.
Sure. Good morning, and thank you for having me on. The process, first of all, is two-tiered. First, if the property is residential and you live in the city of Detroit and the property is in the city of Detroit, you must first appeal to what's called the Board of Assessors, and that window opens February 1st and closes February 15th. That's for all residential properties.
So if you don't like your taxes, you have 15 days to appeal it. Otherwise, you're barred from doing that for the year.
Otherwise, you lose the opportunity. Now, what has happened in the past is sometimes the assessment notices notifying the homeowners of their rights do not go out on time or they are not delivered on time. So the residents have lost in the past their opportunity to appeal to the Board of Assessors that opens February 1st. So whether you received a notice of assessment or not, and the home is in the city of Detroit, you really should go down to the assessor's office between February 1st and February 15th and find out what your assessment is, whether you agree with it or not, and appeal to the assessor to reconsider the assessment. That's the first step for residential in Detroit.
But the hearings to determine whether it was proper or not don't happen in that 15-day period, do they?
What happens in that 15-day period is just a one-on-one meeting with some of the assessing staff to ask them to reconsider the current assessment. They will then receive a formal notice whether the assessment stayed the same or it was reduced. Once they receive that assessment, and even if they don't receive that decision, then the March Board of Appeals is when the hearings actually take place, and they again have the right to appeal to the March Board of Appeals. But in order to get to the March Board of Appeals, only in the city of Detroit, you must go through the first Board of Assessors, which is February 1st to the 15th. The rest of the cities have the March Board of Appeals, and usually those notices will go out the last week, somewhere around the last week of February, and the board opens up usually the first or second Tuesday of March.
So the city of Detroit makes you go through the extra step of having, in that 15-day period, of actually having to sit down with somebody in the assessor's office, and they make a determination, which you then can appeal to the Board of Appeals if you don't agree with.
So it's a matter of question. But what about commercial buildings? Is that the same process?
I'm going to get to commercial buildings in a second. Let me just finish the residential side. Whether you receive a notice or not, in all other cities in Michigan, you have the right to appeal to the March Board of Appeals. And once the decision is made by the March Board of Review, whether they're going to reduce your assessment or not, then you have the right to appeal to the Michigan Tax Tribunal, and that deadline is July 31st. So that completes the residential side. On the commercial side, you do not have to appeal to the March Board of Review or the Board of Assessors in the city of Detroit. And it is not it is not something that I advise people to do, because typically folks that sit on the March Board of Review or the Board of Assessors are not necessarily trained in the complicated elements that affect value on the commercial side. And due to the time constraints, it's often extremely difficult to explain all those elements within a five-minute period to a Board of Appeals.
So you have 5 minutes to make the presentation to the Board of Appeals?
Yes. Typically, it's about 5 to 10 minutes. And commercial properties, as probably you know, Keith, there are many elements that affect value. It's not like a home where you can look at other homes in the neighborhood and say, oh, okay, my home is worth X. Commercial properties are an extremely different animal, and so I generally advise people, if you do have a commercial property, you don't have to go to the March Board. I would skip the March Board and go straight to the Michigan Tax Tribunal, and that deadline is May 31st. Once you get to the Tax Tribunal, then you're arguing in front of somebody who is trained to understand the various elements that affect value on the commercial side.
Just real quick, what are some of the... What are some of the things that affect a commercial building that's different, say, from a residential?
Well, vacancy is one. So tax day is December 31st. So all the taxes, your tax assessment level for 2019 is based on the condition and status of the property as of tax day, which is December 31st, 2018. So if you have a strip center, for example, or a multi-tenant building or an apartment building, let's say that was half empty due to fire damage, then there's no reason for you to be paying taxes on a property that's assumed stable, despite the fact that it wasn't on December 31st. Or let's say the property owner decided to remodel the building and he kept it vacant so that it's under construction. Again, vacancy equals no cash flow equals no value. And that is something that the courts have supported, that vacancy does have a direct effect on value. Deferred maintenance is something that has a direct effect on commercial buildings. Now, deferred maintenance does affect the residential side, but it's much more dramatic on the commercial side because it's much more expensive. You need a new roof. The heating unit is broken down. There's a crack in the floor. There's a structural issue. All those things go to value. What I advise property owners to do, especially on the commercial side and on the residential side, is take note of the condition of the property on December 31st. Now, we've passed that for this year, but it's a good lesson to know for next year. Take a lot of pictures and document what is the condition of the property so that when the process starts of appeal, it's not only your word, which you can sign an affidavit saying, you know, that this was the condition, and that does typically stand up in the tax appeal process, but you also have evidence with pictures.
Well, if it hasn't changed in the month and a half, you can still take pictures and sign the affidavit that this was the condition on December 31st, right?
Absolutely, absolutely. And if it is a multi-tenant building, I would document what the cash flow was. What are you receiving below market rent? Are you receiving above market rent? What's your rent structure is? What is your expense structure is?
I think in this particular
all those go to value.
I think in this particular case, Keith is the sole proprietor of the building, right?
Yes.
So
is it a multi-tenant building?
It's a factory. It was a factory converted into a gym.
A gym?
Yes.
Okay. So is it tenant occupied?
Yes.
Okay, well, see, that's another thing that will affect value, and the condition of the lease. What rent are you getting? Any investment property, the first thing the judge is going to ask is, talk to me about your cash flow and expenses. Talk to me about that lease.
See, the bottom line, I got my nonprofit is in there, and it can help barely pay the bills, and I'm paying out of my pocket the taxes and stuff like that.
See, there you go. That is something that, you know, you're hardly getting any rent. You're having to subsidize the property. That probably goes to demand, which goes to vacancy, which goes to to low value. So that's why I explain to people that commercial properties do not belong at the March Board of Appeals. They belong to be argued in front of a trained magistrate or judge at the tax tribunal level because they understand these things. When you say, well, look, I do have a tenant in there, but I keep a tenant in there to keep the building from being vandalized. So therefore, I subsidize everything else, but I don't want the building to become vacant because then my losses are going to be greater.
In this particular case, I know that he had the nonprofit had revenue from the city of Detroit or from Detroit Public Schools.
Right.
That got cut off, which in turn forced the owner, this time it's Keith, that had to subsidize the nonprofit to be able to stay in that building.
See, another thing, too, like right now, I got to go on my pension to pay for the taxes that's including water bills, interest and penalties and stuff like that. It's utterly ridiculous.
Well, that is definitely something that a trained professional like myself will sit with you and analyze the building and let you know how, if you have a case and how you can proceed. You mentioned something, you mentioned an important point, Keith, and that's taxes. If there are delinquent taxes on a property and the property owner wants to appeal their taxes, that's going to be a very weak case because the judge is going to first want the property brought up to clear back taxes on the property before that they will consider seriously your case. It's not a requirement, but it has sometimes tendency to lean a decision in a certain way. People will tell me, well, while I'm appealing my assessment, do I have to pay my taxes? Yes, you always have to pay your taxes. One does not have anything to do with the other.
But I'm having problems. I got to go on my pension right now to pay for taxes. They put the water bill on.
Yeah, they lean the water bill on.
They lean the water bill. But the bottom line is it was another corporation that had the water under its name. Now they're putting it on my new corporation. the corporation, it's now that and tied it to my tax, to my my building. Now I got, that's part of the tax problem.
Well, water bill stays with the property address, yes, not with whoever the owner is. So that's why it hopped from one corporation to another. It's really staying, it's leaning the property itself.
But yeah, one of the big things that has happened in the city of Detroit, and there's been a lot of meetings on it, is that there's been a new way that they assess on the runoff of the water. And one of the things that it has really started to affect is churches, because they're nonprofits. They don't pay taxes, but a water bill is not considered a tax under the interpretation. And so they are getting hit, and they're going back and they're backdating, and they're going, like, some of these places are have to pay $20,000, $30,000, $40,000 in old water bills, because they said the runoff of the cost of what was going on in terms of the new water bill being in existence.
That water is sewage, man.
Yeah, that's an issue that I am very much familiar with, and that has to do with if the property is able to absorb the rainwater versus that water going into the sewer system and becoming resulting in expenses for the city to deal with. That has nothing to do with the tax assessments. That is a totally different issue that has to appeal to the water department. I'm not really familiar with the process, but I can tell you that a very high water bill really has nothing to do with the tax assessment.
So
the
if I want to use your services,
the value.
If I want to use your services, what do I have to do?
You have to give me a call, and then we will chat.
Yeah, what's your phone number, real quick?
A lot of questions on the property, and then we'll decide what's the best strategy to move forward.
And your phone number is 313-277-1986. 1986. Okay.
I was going to say, as a homeowner, I ran into quite an issue where my place was way over-assessed, and it wasn't until it went to the Michigan Tax Tribunal that it was corrected. It took a few years, and so I had to pay taxes that were way above what I should have had to pay, but when it finally came back, it was retroactive, and I got all that back. So it's worth it to hang in there and to appeal to the tribunal.
It is worth, and you said something also important, and that's the issue of once I appeal, is it retroactive? Once a property owner appeals in 2019 and the property owner can prove that for the last, let's say, 5 years, the property was overassessed, they cannot go back in time and appeal their taxes. Now, the assessor, on the other hand, if they catch a mistake, not an overassessment, but an error, a factual error in how the property was assessed, they have the right to go back 3 years and reassess the property accordingly. But the property owner, if they do think that their property is overassessed and has been for several years, the first thing I would do is go down to the assessor's office and ask for the field sheet to see what are the facts on which the current assessment is being assessed. So I had a client one time that he built a house, and initially the blueprints called for a four-car garage, but he ended up building a two-car garage, but the city was still assessing him as a four-car garage. So we were able to go back 3 years and reassess the property because something happened and they ended up not building the garage.
So it was actually a factual dispute, then? It's not.
It has to be a factual dispute. And that could be retroactive, but a dispute based on value can only be for the current year in question.
Okay, no, what they said was, since I had appealed to them on time, that regardless of how long the state took to hear my case, that it was retroactive to when I first appealed.
Sure, it's told back to the time that you filed the case.
That is actually very correct, and I will tell you something else about this. If it takes the tax tribunal 3 years to hear your case, and during the Great Recession, it was taking the tax tribunal a long time to hear cases. Yes, the decision is retroactive to the date that you filed the case. On top of that, if you do win your case, you also have, there are certain conditions where you can actually collect interest on the money that you overpaid in the meantime.
Okay. I want to thank you for coming on with us very, very much. Again, your phone number is 313-277-1986. You got any tax issues both on commercial and on housing? We appreciate you joining us today.
Thank you for having me on. Bye-bye.
We're about to go to break. Otis and Joe, hold on. We're going to get to you right after the break.
In opposition, no matter the game, we both shared the same vision. Decisions to split us in the place that life seemed to hit us.
Are you getting the most out of your Medicare plan? Are you sure? Many people with Medicare are eligible for plans that include extra benefits in addition to those found in original Medicare. Benefits like dental, vision, and prescription drug coverage. Call now to see if you're eligible to enroll. The consultation is free with no obligation to enroll. In addition to hospital and medical coverage, at no extra cost, you could also get coverage for prescription drugs, dental, hearing, vision, and more. In many areas, plans with benefits are available with $0 copays for many services, $0 monthly premiums, or $0 deductibles. That's hospital, medical, prescription drug, dental coverage, and more included in one plan with premiums that may be as low as $0 a month. Call now to see if you're eligible to enroll. The consultation is free and there's no obligation to enroll.
Call 1-800-571-8580. That's 1-800-571-8580.
So, you've decided to go to college. That's cool. So, pop quiz. Which is a better way to earn your degree? Commute to college and fill your gas tank, get stuck in traffic, drive in bad weather, try to find a parking space, walk a half mile to class, or learn online at Independence University. In the park on a bench, on the beach on a towel, or on your couch with your kid, your campus is wherever you want it to be. You don't go to college. College goes to you. That's Independence. That's Independence University. You schedule classes around your schedule, and all your supplies, including a brand new laptop and tablet, are included with tuition. At Independence U, you'll learn from professional instructors with real work experience. You'll get personal support in school and employment assistance when you graduate. Get your degree, but keep your life. That's Independence. That's Independence University. So if you're really smart, you'd call now.
Call 1-800-556-7791.
Independence U, for an independent you.
Call 1-800-556-7791.
Good morning. You're listening to Robert Ficano and Keith Williams and Scotty Boman. We've had some callers hold on here. We appreciate it. Joe, you're on with the three of us here. Joe, you're on.
Yes, I was just listening to the conversation, and Keith kind of took some of my thunder. The reason things are different is because people are different now. In the city of Detroit, the churches have changed. It is not no conversion. It is not no conviction. It's not no redemption. It's just that politically, I'm going to be connected to this church, that church, and I'm going to get in office. I'm going to do what I want to do. I'm not going to concern myself with people. Yeah, people owned stuff back in the day. Yeah, drugs came in and tore up the neighborhoods, but everybody kept quiet about everything. Everything in the city of Detroit has been destroyed, from education, from business, and nobody's saying nothing. That's not how leaders operate. Leaders are accountable to God. And because none of them are willing to take the steps and speak out, that's why you have what you have. You have a bunch of cowards. They're self-serving people, and that's all in the Bible. You have a blessed day.
All right, thanks. Thanks for holding on, Joe. Otis, you're on with Bob Ficano, Keith Williams, Scotty Boman.
Yeah, how you doing, Executive Ficano, Commissioner Williams, and Mr. Scotty Bone? This is Otis Mathis from African Town.
Otis, you used to be on the commission at one time yourself, weren't you?
Yeah, I represent E-Course, Wood in Southwest Detroit. And
I remember you. I remember you back when I was sheriff.
Yeah.
Sure.
Right, because I chaired that. I mean, I was the chair of that, the committee for the sheriff. But Keith is right. One thing about these drainage fees, that's what it's called. It seemed like once they started putting the water and sewage fees on, tying them to the house, it really acts almost as if it's taxes. You know, your house going debt at one time is just that, you know, you deal with the water and sewage, with the water and sewage department. Now you can have so much debt on your house that it acts like a tax. You don't pay, you could lose your house. Now with these drainage fees, which there's no way to measure
rainwater. I haven't figured that one out. We know why these are fees, so people don't have to vote on them. And if you don't pay them, just like he's saying, Commissioner Williams is saying, he's going into his retirement to cover these drainage fees. You know, something that's going to have an effect, a negative effect.
Otis, do you know how they actually determine the runoff fees? I mean, if you have a skyscraper in downtown Detroit, it seems like the rain hitting that would create a lot more rain to actually run down the building and go into the sewer system, right? Versus, but they actually do it on the runoff through the property. You know, you could have a parking lot, and that's probably the worst thing you can have. That would be the most expensive at this point, I presume.
But they're using a roof. That's what they're doing. Also, not only your parking lot, I mean, not only your driveways, your sidewalks, and the sad part about it, those seniors who have been in their homes 40, 50 years, and eventually got an opportunity to renovate and put those cement patios in the back of their homes, you know, 50, you're now on fixed income, and this drainage fee is taking that their patios in the back are unpenetratable ground. So not only do you have to pay, like, the you know, you have driveways, but if a building is 50 stories high and the roof on the building is a 10 by 10, just you have a lot of apartment buildings underneath it, they don't count the side of the building. They count the roof of the building. So if my roof on a single-family home is a 10 by 10, and a 50-story building roof is a 10 by 10, like a shotgun apartment building, we pay the same fees for runoff. And that gives it advantage to the big money people that really don't have to pay all that money in drainage fees. And if they got a parking lot, fine. If they don't have a parking lot and parking on the street, well, they don't. That's not a cost to them. That's the difference for the haves and the have-not, is that you can end up paying the same thing, even though, you know, with your tax credits and things, the drainage fees is also is equal to what you pay on a single-family home.
So it's only predicated on the size of the roof and not necessarily, like, if you have a tall building, let's say, you know, if you have the Guardian or whatever, one of those buildings, at that point, the runoff running down the length of the building doesn't matter. It's the size of the roof.
Right. Just the size of the roof. And just think if you had a ranch home that, I mean, not as large, but just example, you had your primary residence was a large roof because it was a ranch. It wasn't a two-story. It was spread out. The Guardian building is straight up. And so your roof squares are the same as the Guardian square. The Guardian building may be worth $50 million. Your house may be worth $500,000. But your drainage fee will be the identical same cost. So the Guardian building, which rents space and make money, your home is the primary. It doesn't make a difference. Like if you're paying your property taxes, your primary gets a discount than your rental or second home. So that's the disadvantage that people are having, and no one is arguing about it. I think the guy just called said it. The churches, the people, they're not arguing and fighting about these things. And I'm going to say this last thing is that as more and more people, and it's not just people keep thinking it's black folks being pushed out of the city of Detroit, but low-income white people are being pushed out of the city of Detroit. At Wayne State, I went back there in 2014 for one of several degrees I've had now to work on about three classes ago. And those white students, because primary Wayne's have a large number of young white people there that live in the city of Detroit, and they're screaming and hollering. They've been pushed out of Midtown. They've been pushed out of Lafayette Towers. A lot of them have Section 8 because they cannot afford those rents. So as blacks are being pushed out, whites are being pushed out of the city. And the sad part is that the suburbs are trying to get our seniors to move in all these senior housing because they got fixed income. Doug's hard for Duggan to get their money, I mean, with drainage fees and things like that, even though the income was cut in Detroit through the state and through the city, is that they are trying to get them to come out there as those office buildings empty out in the suburbs to come to downtown Detroit. This is a lot of game plan with white, black, and others, and we keep focusing on blacks being abused. But that's the reason why the people who have the same income, blue-collar, white, black, and others, they separate us from fighting together. GM closed down Pole Town Plant. They didn't close down Pole Town Plant on all the black folks. It was more than just blacks working in the Pole Town Plant.
Sure. And just real quick, Otis, African Town, tell us what that's about and what you're doing with it.
Well, Africantown is a zip code 4217, a part of Southwest. Like one extreme of Southwest is Corktown. We on the other extreme across the Ruiz River. The community was black, started moving here in the late 1800s and developed it. They don't even talk about this neighborhood at Wayne State University. It was the last community built in the city of Detroit. That's why it had the more modern baby bungalows before Victoria Park came along. So what we're doing is identify research on the community, the African-American community, all the last black hospital where Ecorse Rupert's and that part of Africantown, Southwest, butt up. The black community had the last black hospital closed in the country. We got the oldest African-American skating ring in the country, one of the famous bakeries that a lot of people, I got a culinary degree, took me 3 years over at Henry Ford, and all the bakers know about people's bakeries in Africantown on 4th Street. My partner and I just bought one of the largest buildings out here about 4 years ago. We opened it up about 5 months ago and started our youth program, opened a grocery store, and trained kids in construction. We look at another building to do the historical building.
If you're working with young kids, I know Keith here has a building that works a lot with young people and stuff like that. You might have some synergy here that could be put together.
Well, we're trying to get others to come on. We want to, our goal is hopefully 2020 is to have the DNA. I just got a kid, my oldest daughter, bought from me, had my DNA tested, but have the group of kids, about 20 DNA tested, so they know specifically where at in Africa that their ancestors came from, not just the generic term Africa. And we're hoping to pull off a trip. We're trying to put the grant funding and ask the marathon to come to the table on a trip like that so kids can go to, you know, just like if you was going to Italy, you know what part of Italy pretty much you came from.
Sure.
At least, you know, and Africans is always just Africa. And so we're working on that. We're also doing that leadership programs, and we're fighting with Land Bank to stop destroying our community. We're looking at Wayne County Land Bank, but the city of Detroit and the city of Detroit Land Bank in particular has taken good homes and allowed them to deteriorate, and we fight not.
So you're saying that the ownership of the homes are with the land bank and they're not being maintained?
Oh, they're not being maintained. We took pictures down there, and went to the Guardian building and others, and they say that the problem is that they don't have the money. The city of Detroit is supposed to cut the grass and shovel the snow. So we're asking them, how do you take a lot that you've had for 5 years and you're supposed to shovel the snow if it's $25, say three times a year, that's $75, and you cut the grass four times a year, it's $175 times 5 years, and you sell it for $100. Who's paying for all that maintenance that's supposed to be going on that's not happening? Or you cut the weeds down in front of a house but not in the back of the house. When we look at it, we took pictures down, and you're not cutting the weeds in front of the house. They're growing up into tall trees and cracking porches. Some beautiful homes. We laid a plan on the table to give us an opportunity to have some homeless veterans or veterans with skills. A project I did when I was a county commissioner, actually, but independent of my commission in the Cash Quarter, we was in the Eddystone. When the veterans renovated the Eddystone, we had no money, and I looked around. Who fixed elevators on aircraft carrier? I'm a Vietnam era sailor. And then you can fix the elevator in the Eddystone. You live here, you're homeless, but you have those skills and trainings. Boilers was fixed. The NAACP National gave me an award on that one. In Wisconsin, because of the uniqueness of the funds, the banks and things, you know, for your money, your deposits, when the savings and loans went bankrupt, they owned a lot of property. HUD and the bank. Federal banking got in an argument. Us today, federal housing. Then the bank said, "But we made the loans to these, what you call them when they went bankrupt? Those savings, not savings and loans. I can't even think of the name of them now." And so then they gave us a house on Shenandoah, Norfolk, to go over there, renovate and sell it at 80% because of the skills we used. The veterans had carpentry, boilers, welding, demolition, all that stuff. You didn't act in military. You just happened to be homeless, but you never forgot your skills. And they gave us that house. We sold it at 80% of market value.
Otis, it sounds like you're doing a lot over there, and keep it up. Are you getting any benefit from the train station being renovated?
No, that's all the way over here. Yeah. Well, it's not even in Corktown. It's over in, Hubbard Farms, but they want to rename it the new Hubbard Farms. And we haven't asked them. I sat on a
board at Fort Wayne back in the day when the county and the city was fighting over the land, and with the Ford Motor Company historians. So hopefully that, because of that relationship, we're looking to see if we can get some funding from them. They do have me on their, the Ford Museum, where I have opportunity to give out tickets to organizations and things like that for the Henry Ford Greenfield Ford Tour, IMAX. I'm part of the board member there. I was very surprised when they asked me.
Okay, hey, that's great you're able to do that. Maybe you might be able to hook up with Keith here and get some of the tickets to some of these kids.
Definitely, and I would love to do, that's what we're trying to do. Yeah, man, we'd love to get with Keith. And I see Keith off and on, so next time we get to put it on our plate to talk about some things together when we bump into each other.
Okay.
One thing that I wanted to just comment on that I heard early on was to talk about the way the water fees are being used like a tax. And that's absolutely correct. Not only with the recent runoff thing really increasing the cost of water, but also that if you simply don't use any water, they bill you as if you do use water. And we had a case, I'm in part of a neighborhood organization. We had a building that had been damaged beyond usability. And so they owned the space that had been donated. It was tax exempt property because it was a nonprofit, but we still got stuck with a huge fee and ultimately had to default on the property and let the land bank have it because of the very high water bills.
The water bill is an ongoing issue. Although I heard the director on there on the radio the other day, and he was talking about that they're down to only 4,000. When you say only, I mean 4,000 is a lot of people that have not been paying their bills and things like that. So, I mean, do you think their program actually works, Otis? Do any of your people?
Well, no, because what the gentleman just said, he's right. That happened to us. When we bought our building, we were very blessed because it was second-generation African-American, and Mr. Agee was 87. So you can imagine his parents who owned it before him, how African-Americans in African town has been very involved, active for, about 100 years or more now. But it was completely gutted. It had been, when it was breaking in buildings, stripping them and things, and the roof was gone, it had been shut down 17 years. Once we bought and registered all that paperwork with the registered deeds, the water department, we started getting a water bill. We had no water lines in there. But we started getting a water bill.
You didn't have any lines in there? That's interesting.
So they had stripped all the water lines out. And so once the water came, they came in and told us what we need to do so they can, put the meter in. They give you a little diagram, what you have to build out. And then all of a sudden, we started getting water bills. So we go back down, my partner, Porter, and I, we go back down to the water department and say, we've got no water running in there. And they said, even though that there's no water running, they still have to charge you. And so we had to build them 4 years. For 3.5 years, we had been getting the water before we got our water on, because we're up and operating a part of our building. But he's right. We got a water bill for not even using water. Then we start getting a drainage fee. It's like, come on now.
Mm-hmm. All right, Otis. Well, we appreciate you coming on and telling us a little bit about Africantown and some of your experiences with the water department. I know that it's challenging at this point. Also, by the way, there was a report that Detroit should have been paid a lot more for the asset, when I say that, in the bankruptcy of the water department, which is interesting. So, okay, Otis, thanks. You have a great Sunday, okay?
Bob, what they're doing, ultimately, the cities are becoming landowners. Instead of being people owning the property, the city's starting to own the property.
They're becoming the landlord.
Yeah, they could become the landlord, and they got to stop making it hard for people to stay in their homes, man. This water runoff fees, what is that affecting? How's that affecting anything?
They say it increases the usage of where it pours into the drains or the sewers. I thought they were built for that, actually, but.
Yeah. Well, it's like nothing, but that hasn't changed. The fee changed, but the conditions,
the infrastructure actually has not changed.
The existence of sewers and water running into them has been going on all along, right? So,
man, it's now part of the Great Lakes Water Authority, and if you want to improve the infrastructure actually in the city of Detroit, trying to charge more outside the city of Detroit is getting pushback from the people that represent those people as well. I mean, it's this cycle that just keeps going on. So what do? They increase your fees inside the city.
To take care of somebody else, to take care of the suburbs.
Yeah, yeah. So it's a vicious cycle that really is going on. And a lot of people that they now allow, you know, now that it is allowed to have the water bill go on the tax bill, it's a way of losing your house. I mean, if it piles up real quick and you go into foreclosure.
I'm wondering if some slick attorney could somehow challenge this as a violation of the Headley Amendment, that it really is a tax, just simply in a different name.
I don't know if it's been challenged or not in the courts. It might have been.
This thing about it's getting ridiculous. What a runoff fees. You know, you're already paying water bills and sewers. Now you got that too.
Yeah. It piles up. And it's hard to be maintaining home ownership, isn't it?
Yeah.
And even worse for an entrepreneur that's trying to do a commercial building as well. I mean, all those fees are astronomical that come with it.
If you don't have, people say, well, don't go in business if you don't have money. But I thought, you know, entrepreneurs just taking risks and trying to make something happen with something, make something out of nothing. Bob, in my building, man, I got so much work to do, man. I don't want to go alone. I own it free and clear. I don't want to go get a loan, so I just piecemeal what I can do, man. Plus, the nonprofit, the kids walk in there. Parents don't want to pay for the services. And it's a vicious cycle, but I keep it moving, you know, and I try to help as many kids as I can come through our situation. But it's rough.
Yeah. Yeah, it takes a lot. Okay, Rick, you're on with Bob Ficano, Keith Williams, and Scotty Boman. Rick?
Okay, didn't want you guys to forget. You were right on the line. Yeah, there was a lawsuit, a class action lawsuit filed on the part of commercial businesses, and it was settled for $29 million. Because it is a tax. I don't care what you call something like that. It's a tax. And even if it was a utility increase, it still should have went to the Public Service Commission or somebody else to okay a tax of that size or an increase of that size, which is hundreds of percent. So that's true, irregardless of that imperious acreage, it's that $768 per. And so that piece should always be taken a look at, because the same thing could happen to residents. The class action lawsuit allowed for them, of course, to get away with the idea of it being unconstitutional in terms of what they did to bring it about in the first place. And so that's the setup. And when you combine that case with where we are now with the residents, I think if they do that strategically, they may be able to make that drainage tax go away. It may come back in another form. But I think that thing is really challengeable to make it go away. Unfortunately, the businesses and the residents were not working collectively so that they could have brought that class action effort as a whole. So it was kind of politically smart and savvy on the part of the city to let them move theirs and to settle it for $29 million. And I still get information from these guys. A lot of them are not seeing it. Many of them who pay tens of thousands of dollars in water bills have seen, you know, little to nothing, some credits here and there and $1,000 here and there. So, you know, it's an issue. So I just wanted to add that. Thanks.
Okay, thanks, Rick. Thanks for calling. There are a lot of issues that are going to be coming up. It looks like with the future with General Motors, Chrysler, Ford, a lot of people are saying that Ford hasn't really made its decision on what it's going to do in terms of cuts and layoffs. That's coming as well. And I know you were at the auto show on Friday, Keith. All the European companies are gone. I mean, the auto show is sort of like a skeleton of itself, isn't it?
Same traditional car, Chrysler, Ford, General Motors.
Yeah, and it's is it?
Why isn't Tesla there? Aren't they an American automaker?
Well, he has a lot of issues. I mean, I just saw today that he's laying off 7% of his workforce.
I thought they'd be included in the auto show. Just
they probably have an invitation to whether you spend the money. It's not cheap to be there. Okay. And a lot of the companies now are saying that they'd rather have the announcements on their own terms and they'd be the center of it instead of like having 50 announcements at the same time. But I've had people that have gone through it, both the Industrial Days and then at the Black Tie event, that say that it's just really a shallow of itself and what it used to be. I mean, we fought really hard to get Cobo Hall ready for it and everything else and the taxes that went into that. And now if it's not being able to be successful in terms of what it was in the past. Now, they're saying it's being moved to June of 2020.
It's cold,
Is it a cold?
It's cold. It was cold Friday night. You know, it's. I think it's a good idea to change it to Senate.
June.
Caucus in June. Yeah.
Okay, and a lot of it though is it going to compete with other events, such as the Grand Prix, and some of the other events that are going to be there during the summer, the River Walk, and everything else. So it's going to be interesting. Or they combine it, I guess. I haven't heard them really define what they want to do or how they're going to change it and what they're going to do. They want to make it more interactive. That's what I understand that the, that they're trying to do. But that's difficult to do. That's,
you know, Bob, I remember we used to have the African-American Festival. We don't have that no more in the city.
Yeah. Did that go away?
Yeah, so I'm going to try to do something myself, Bob. But that's ridiculous, man. You don't got a city of 85% African-American. And you don't have a festival or something, some cultural things for every nationality. The city should let everybody show the greatness of their cultures.
You used to have ethnic festivals down at Hart Plaza like every week.
Say that again, Scotty?
You used to have ethnic festivals down at Hart Plaza every week. And so the different cultural groups would, you know, and local people would have businesses go down there and use the set up booths and so forth. And, yeah, it doesn't seem like they really do that anymore.
No. I don't know. This thing has been, the space has been taken over by corporate elites and corporate, the corporate way of thinking. You know, you got Dan Gilbert. He owns half Detroit himself.
Probably owns three-quarters of Detroit right now.
Three-quarters of Detroit. And then you got General Motors, the classic conglomerates, and they're doing their thing. And so where you got to go to the neighborhoods to do something to stir up a little ethnic pride somewhere, you know?
Yeah, and, you know, one of the things in talking about the neighborhoods and stuff, and perhaps with entrepreneurs, is shut down this SBA, the Small Business Loan Association that the federal government runs, apparently is shut down, and a lot of people aren't able to process a lot of their loans and stuff.
I need right now a letter from the IRS, a transcript. I can't get them.
Yeah,
you can't go online and get them.
Oh, you can't even go online and download it?
No.
Huh. Yeah. Well, the shutdown yesterday, the president tried to trade off. It seems like there's 800,000 people that are not getting paid. That's, you can say what you want. That's still un-American that they're expecting you to work for free and continue on. And I think they could probably close the shutdown real quick. You know what it is? TSA goes on strike. At that point, you'll close down
that and the border agents.
Which ones?
If the border agents go on strike, that might have an effect.
Yeah.
Can they go on strike, though?
Technically, no, they can't. The federal government, the federal law does not permit public employees to go on strike. But at the same time, you're supposed to be paid.
Bob, but the ridiculous thing is he said Mexico was going to pay for the wall.
Yeah. Well, they've moved clearly away from that.
But, Bob, then open up the government then. He's listening to Rush Limbaugh and Coulter and that other woman. It's ridiculous. They sit in there.
Sean Hannity.
Yeah, they live in gated communities, multimillionaires off of talking, and they want to control the whole country.
Yeah, yeah.
They don't want to live with poor people. They don't go. They don't go live in the fires with folks in Mississippi. They're oblivious to those folks, but they still want to go. They still want to control the country.
Yeah. Well, the shutdown. Actually, I have to say though, the shutdown is starting to look bad for both sides.
Yes.
I mean, get it moving one way or another with it.
But the guy don't lie. He don't negotiate. He lies.
Well, yeah. They walk in and he just demands way it's going to be.
Hold on. They had a deal before the holidays.
Yes.
The Republicans and the Democrats.
And then they listened to Rush Limbaugh and Coulter, and they said this isn't a good deal, so he decided that it wasn't going to be a good deal.
Yeah, now, I don't understand how they call, like, giving dreamers a break amnesty. Amnesty means forgiving someone for doing something wrong, but we talk about minors coming in with their parents and growing up in this country.
Part of it, he says he temporarily imposed an amnesty for the DACA individuals, but it's temporary.
But he caused the problem.
Yeah.
It was working okay. They changed it.
Yeah, but not only that, it means it's temporary. So as soon as he gets his money, then does he change the program? Nobody trusts him. Nobody knows what he's going to do. And he says he's this great negotiator. He doesn't negotiate anything.
Bob, he called Cohen a rat. He sounded like a mob boss. Called him a rat. Threatened his family.
Man, this guy is, man, it's ridiculous, man. You, now this is a poll that his base is starting to run away from him.
Oh, really? It's 30%?
Right-wing hardliner slam. They call it an amnesty. So this guy's confused. He needs to show some leadership and tell him to go take a hike.
Yeah, it's a mess. And one of the problems is, though, that nobody can believe what he says. If you go in and you cut a deal with Donald Trump, you don't know if that one of his aides gets to him and then he tweets that the deal's not going to happen. And he's done that to his own party. Right. He's done that to Ryan and to McConnell. McConnell won't even touch it anymore. He says, look, as soon as you agree to it and you say you're going to sign it, that's when I'm going to pass it in the Senate. Although he's been missing in action, too. They call him the turtle.
Oh, yeah, McConnell. Man, he needs to go, man. All he has to do is bring it up, vote for it, and then override the veto. The government is open.
Yeah, yeah. Well, like I said, if they really want to take care of this, then what you do is go TSA, go on strike. Once you actually impact what's going to happen on the at the airports and things like that, people are going to pay attention. People are going to pay attention, and you feel bad. You see the public these federal employees going to food banks and things like that. I mean, they're supposed to be paid.
Donald Trump has never lived like that in his life, man.
He's never lived paycheck to paycheck.
Yeah,
no. He's too busy.
He lied. His father gave him $1 million, and there was a tax fraud how they made the money.
He actually gave him millions of dollars the way they had it set up with it. I understand this last one was a product of his son-in-law and daughter putting it together that, in terms of this the speech he made yesterday. The only thing, and I'll say this, everybody's going to I understand that it wasn't worth it and it was going to be rejected. I just wish the Democrats would have waited till he actually presented it, then rejected it. They were saying that they weren't going to take it no matter what. It makes it look like they're uncooperative in trying to settle this thing. Should have waited till he made the presentation, then, and honestly believed that it wasn't going to work, then just say so. To say so in advance makes it look like there isn't kind of real good faith that's going on trying to negotiate it. Although you can't really negotiate real well with Donald Trump.
Donald Trump, man, I don't know where they got this guy from, man. But I think
they got him from New York.
Yeah, man, he's been in the imagination of people's mind. You're fired and all that other
stuff. Yeah, well, TV helped.
People buy into entertainment.
Yeah. That's why they say people predict who's going to be the next president. I say it could be Oprah. Yeah. I mean, think about it.
I thought that she probably could win, if she ran. The thing is, would she
to seriously govern, which is going to, strain no matter who you are if you do it legitimately.
One thing is to talk it, and another thing is to do it. You got interest groups got part of the budget.
They got control of it.
So you cut somebody else's stuff out, man. You get all, man, I remember the 13 check. Man, I lost my election because of the 13 check.
For those of you that don't know what the 13 check is, the retirees are supposed to get a 13th check at the end of Christmas. And the fund was unbalanced. We couldn't balance it. And so we said, well, we want to save all your pensions. Instead, we'll have to stop the 13 check for a while. And, man.
Man, I think that contributed to my demise, too. Because for the 13 check, man, it was coming after me, man. I thought they were my friends, man. I took one for you, Bob.
We all took one, believe me, with that. It was a difficult vote. I know, but it saved the whole pension. A system is what they were doing, but I know it wasn't viewed that way, and you're going to get a matter of
opinion. All the work I did, the good work,
it's evaporated.
Like the guy called in. Like the guy called, go sit somewhere, man.
Scotty, what do you got this week? Anything exciting?
Well, one thing I did notice that was kind of fascinating was we have this guy who was dancing over in the streets over in on the east side.
And he got arrested.
He got arrested?
Yeah, well, they gave him a hard time. I don't know what they would arrest him for, but I know, there are people complaining about what he was saying and things, and it's like, well, whatever happened to the First Amendment? So the guy wants to dance, and his music might have some swear words in it. Well, so
a lot of rap songs have swear words
in them. I never hear them.
Derogatory
towards
women. I just see
him dancing. When I drive by in the car, it'd bring a smile to my face. I mean, I thought, hey, this guy's cool.
Why did they arrest him, did they say?
Well, because apparently there were some neighbors who were just being a little bit gray-faced about everything and just going, oh, this guy, he's bad influence, or, he's listening to that obscene rap music and all this kind of stuff. And
you're going to arrest a lot of people on that. If you that's going to be the standard.
And one of them, I guess, were in the Police Community Relations Council, so they managed to draw the police into the thing.
Okay. Well, I want to thank everybody for calling in. Our guest, Jumana Judah, today as well on the appeals. I want to thank Scotty Boman and Keith Williams.
I won't be here next. I'm going to church.
Okay, he's going to church. All right, well, we're going to set it up and see where we're going to go with it. Our substitute board operator, we appreciate very much what you've been able to do today. Waiting for Maxine to come back next week. So to all of you, have a great week, and we'll be here next week from 8 to 10, 910 AM Superstation.
Well, how you been, baby? But I'm saying, even though we probably link up every now and then with minimal combo, look, it's really good to see you, friend.